Mount Fuji, Mount Kilimanjaro, Mount Olympus, and Mount Cody. Who you got? Terrance Cody was a larger-than-life figure, a diamond in the rough that helped put into motion one of the greatest dynasties of our time. His life and career consisted of ups and downs, and today we're gonna go back and take a look at it. We're gonna take a look at Cody before his football career, after his football career, and of course, everything in between. So if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to click the thumbs up button. Also, I've dropped tons of these What Happened To videos, and I even have them listed out into seasons. So after you finish this one, you might want to comb through those seasons and see if there's any of your favorite forgotten players in there that you want to take a look at and find out what happened to. With that being said, without further ado, this is what happened to Mount Cody. Cue the way. Yeah, you'll never know. This is Alabama's practice locker room, a locker room they only use for practice. Nice place. But before Terrance Cody was ever affiliated with this mega rich university, he grew up as a poor kid in Fort Myers, Florida. Cody has 7 younger siblings and his family struggled to make ends meet. His mom worked 2 jobs and his dad worked in construction, and with those incomes they managed to get by. However, when Cody was 11, his dad tragically lost his life in a car accident. That tragedy obviously damaged the family emotionally, but it also took its toll financially. As you might imagine, Cody was a big kid. He wore a size 10 shoe when he was only 8 years old. Dude had a lot of energy and athleticism for a big guy and wanted to show what he can do, and what better place to put his talents on display than on a football field. Unfortunately, he was unable to showcase that talent due to the fact that he was well over the weight limit. He knew early on, Pop Warner was not an option. When Cody reached high school, he walked in as a ninth grader that was already bigger than most seniors. Dude was 6'2", 275 pounds as a freshman. After a solid freshman season, his coach predicted that he'd one day make millions in the NFL. And I don't want to rush the story, but yeah, his coach was right. Even still, at that time, the prediction may have gone to Cody's head a bit, because by his sophomore year in high school, his grades had dropped to the point that he was academically ineligible. It was so bad that he missed not only his entire 10th grade year, but also his 11th grade year. So 2 years of high school ball gone down the drain due to poor grades. Now this likely had a lot to do with Cody's living situation. Again, his mom was struggling and this dude was growing like crazy. He didn't have shoes that could fit, clothes that could fit, and trying to feed this dude with 7 other kids and a limited budget, I'm sure proved difficult. At the end of Cody's junior year in high school, he moved in with the family of a high school teammate. And it's no surprise that once Cody's needs were met, his grades improved, and by his senior year, he was back on the football field. Cody took the field as a senior and didn't miss a step. Dude completely dominated with his size and ridiculous athleticism. One game, he played against star running back Noel Devine. He pummeled dude, hit him so hard, Noel not only had to come out of the game, but was spotted throwing up on the sideline. After that senior season, colleges came knocking. The University of Miami and USF. But while Cody's grades were finally good enough to allow him to play high school ball, they still weren't good enough to qualify him to play in college. Therefore, he had to go the JUCO route. He attended Mississippi Gulf Coast College and impressed coaches immediately with his workouts. They couldn't believe how easily this 300-pounder was doing box jumps. He damn near looked like a skill player out there, to the point that they actually used him at a skill position at running back during goal line situation. Good luck tackling this dude. At his true position, Cody immediately became the anchor to the number one defense in the state, and he helped lead that team to an undefeated record and a JUCO national championship. Still, Cody struggled to get offers despite racking up 79 tackles and 6 sacks in 2 seasons while playing D-tackle. So what was the problem? Well, the dude had packed on 135 pounds since his freshman year in college. He was now 410 pounds. Teams felt he was too big and needed to get his weight under control before he'd be able to contribute at the D1 level. Once he got down to 385, the entire SEC was clamoring for dude. Eventually, he decided on Alabama. Now keep in mind, the 2007 season before Cody got there, Alabama was 7-6. That was Nick Saban's very first year at the school. But in true Nick Saban fashion, he walked in there and brought in one of the top recruiting classes in the nation. Julio Jones, Tyler Love, BJ Scott, Jarrell Harris, Mark Barron, Courtney Upshaw, Mark Ingram, and more. But just that alone is 8 top 150 ranked players. But one of the biggest additions was the 39th ranked JUCO player, a diamond in the rough, a hidden gem, Terrance Cody. As a JUCO junior, Cody made an immediate impact as Bama saw his defense go from giving up 128 rush yards per game the year before to only giving up 78 yards in 2008. After one season at Bama, Cody was already regarded as a top pick in the draft. And despite the fact that there's little to no upside in returning for that dreaded senior year, Cody did it anyway. But it actually kind of worked out this time, and I totally understand why Cody made the decision that he made. Cody was beloved at Bama, and for a player who only played 2 years in high school, had to go the JUCO route, I'm sure he was in love with the status that he had at Alabama. As far as money is concerned, reports would come out well after Cody's college days about he and other Bama players accepting money for autographs. Of course, this wasn't any real money that would compare to what you can get in the NFL, but Cody, growing up poor, was probably happy with whatever he was getting. He also had a weird situation on his Facebook page where he kind of announced that he would be going pro after that first year at Bama, but he'd later say it was just a joke done by his girlfriend. I could speculate. It's a lot of places I could go with that. But you know what? I'm gonna just call BS and keep on moving. Cody dropped another 10 pounds going into his senior season, a move that helped him to stay on the field in third down situations. As y'all know, D-tackles aren't exactly stat sheet fillers, but it didn't matter. Everybody could see Cody's impact on Bama's defense. For anybody that doubted, he put a stamp on it on October 24th, 2009 versus Tennessee. Mark Ingram was having a phenomenal season to this point and was a candidate for the Heisman Trophy that he would go on to win, but in this game, Bama was up 12-3 when Ingram lost his first fumble of his college career at the worst possible time. Tennessee recovered it and went down and scored. Then things got really scary for Bama as Tennessee recovered an onside kick. They moved the ball downfield a little bit and got into position to kick a 44-yard field goal that would have won the game. At this point, Cody had already blocked the kick earlier in that same fourth quarter and was primed to block another. Tennessee left guard Corey Sullins was giving up 84 pounds to Cody, and no amount of technique was gonna make up for that weight difference. Not to mention, next to him he had Marcel Darius and another 300 pounder, Brandon Dederick. That Tennessee line had to be shook. Cody and the squad ran through the line so clean that dude didn't even have to jump to block the kick. He put his hand up, blocked it, game over, undefeated season, saved. Cody was a hero, and Bama would go on to eventually win the national championship. After that Tennessee game, though, some people were calling for Cody to be added into the Heisman race, which is a huge accomplishment for any defensive player, but especially a defensive tackle. Like I said earlier, Cody's teammate Mark Ingram went on to win, but it's possible that had Cody not blocked that kick versus Tennessee and Bama lost that game due to Mark Ingram's fumble, things could have played out differently. Leading up to the draft, Cody had more issues with his weight ballooning. Ideally, teams wanted him to be around 340 pounds, but he showed up to the Senior Bowl at 370. He managed to get his weight down to 354 by the combine, but the 2010 draft had plenty of D-tackle talent, and with teams questioning Cody's commitment, there were plenty of other defensive linemen to choose from in that draft. Definitely not a good year to be slacking off. During that 2010 draft, when Cody came out, Ndamukong Suh was taken second overall, Gerald McCoy third overall. D-lineman was flying off the board and Cody was still sitting there. And while a bunch of D-linemen were taken before him, he still didn't have to wait that long as he was taken in the second round, 57th overall by the Ravens. Cody's NFL career definitely didn't stack up to his college days. Besides 1 year, he never even became a consistent starter. No All-Pros, no Pro Bowls, no real individual accolades to speak of. He was, however, a part of the Ravens' 2012 Super Bowl team, but like I said before, his playing time was limited. Regardless of that, there's not very many people who can say they won a championship in junior college, won a national championship in college, and then won a Super Bowl in the league. Like, that is an amazing accomplishment. With that said, Cody seemed to have taken his foot off the gas after college, and the fact that he fell to the second round likely cost him about $7 million on that first contract. Sometimes these dudes make so much money that $7 million that might have got away here or there doesn't seem like a huge deal, but when you don't make it to that second long-term contract, it is a big deal. Cody's rookie deal was for about $3.5 million. Like I said, if he was taken in the first round, it probably would have been closer to 10. So then when you look at it, Cody was already having some trouble staying on the field. He had already not really lived up to the hype, and then in the final years of his contract, injuries. In 2013, Cody had to have hip surgery, and any momentum he may have had going into the end of his contract was completely wiped out with that injury. In 2014, the Ravens did re-sign Cody to a one-year deal, likely to just see how that hip would recover, but unfortunately, Cody never shook back. That deal was for less than $1 million, and Cody was never re-signed after that deal. The year of Cody's release had to be one of the toughest years of his life. Not only was he released from the NFL, ending a lifelong dream, but he was also indicted on animal cruelty charges. 15 total counts, including several felonies. Essentially, here's what happened. Cody and his girlfriend owned several dogs. All of the dogs on the property were in good health with the exception of one, a canary mastiff named Taz. For some reason, Taz had been placed in the garage away from all the other dogs, and he was forced to stay out there for so long that the dog starved. It went from weighing over 100 pounds to less than 50 pounds during what the veterinarians estimate to be anywhere from 4 to 6 weeks with no food. When Cody finally went out to get the dog, he took him to the vet, but the dog didn't make it. That too little too late trip to the vet launched a full investigation on Cody's property. When the authorities came and searched Cody's house, they found an unclean dog cage that had been isolated from everything else. They also, for some weird reason, found an alligator. Now, while Cody did get some charges for the alligator, it didn't really play a big part in this investigation. But why did this man own an alligator? Like, I don't know, man. I guess you could take the kid out of Florida, but y'all know the rest. When Cody went to court, the prosecutors argued that he'd killed his dog on purpose, but the lady from the vet said it was clearly a case of neglect, but it wasn't malicious. The simple argument is that why would Cody have brought the dog to the vet in the first place if his intentions were to kill the dog? It doesn't make any sense. Also, the vet testified that Cody literally broke down into tears when she told him that she wouldn't be able to save the dog. So he brought the dog to the vet and mourned when the dog actually passed. In my opinion, Cody was unbelievably irresponsible. How do you forget that your dog is in the damn garage for over a month? Honestly, I don't know. Now, Cody's girlfriend at the time was 8 months pregnant, and the courts ruled that the dog was not her responsibility because she technically didn't own the dog or the property. So despite the fact that she too was indicted, she walked away clear of all charges. Cody, on the other hand, ended up having to serve 9 months in jail for neglect. The fact that all the other dogs were taken care of lead me to believe one of two things. Maybe Cody and his girlfriend just had it out for this one dog. Dog did something, they decided to punish him by leaving it in the garage for 4 to 6 weeks. That's technically a possibility, but it seems extremely unlikely. This whole case is pretty weird. I don't think Cody and his girlfriend put the dog in the garage and just left it for a month in order to punish the dog. That doesn't really compute. Like, I don't think that's what happened. They did have a lot going on. They had a child on the way. Cody had this injury. He was coming to the end of his NFL contract. And as crazy as it sounds, it seems like he just got caught up in everything else and forgot that he had that dog in the damn garage. And while it's technically possible that he took the dog to the vet to make it look like he wasn't guilty, if he would have just let the dog die at his house, nobody would have known anyway. If he was truly that cold-blooded to starve the dog on purpose, it seems like he might have just fed it to that alligator that he was also keeping at his home. That's a disturbing thought, but it would have been an easy way to get rid of the dog if that's really what he wanted to do. I don't think he did it on purpose, bro. It doesn't make sense. Today, that situation and his NFL career alike are both behind Terrance Cody. He can't own animals anymore, which is probably for the best, and he still has a net worth of about $1 million. He currently coaches some youth football and works in his family's business back in the state of Florida. And it sucks, but as is often the case, Cody's last moments in the spotlight were absolutely some of his worst. With that said, I and hopefully you guys will choose to remember Cody from his best moments. Super Bowl champion, BCS national champion, and an All-American. He helped bring financial stability to his family that desperately needed it his whole life. And he's put the future generation of the Cody family in a much better starting position than he had. So yeah, that's the Mount Cody that I'll remember.